explain to you the nature of the true aim of yoga, which is samadhi. And it is well said in an aphorism. Yoga samadhi. Yoga is nothing but union with reality. Or any degree of reality as you are able to conceive. Yoga has no other meaning. So it became necessary for me to go into great detail into the inner significance of this wonderful process called attunement with reality, known in Sanskrit as samadhi. These detailed presentations that I place before you, you will never find in any written textbook. What I have given you is not a textbook information. It is a product of deep thinking, analysis and conviction, which you should keep in your mind, because you will not hear it again and again told several times, nor will the books tell you anything about this matter. Mostly the yoga commentaries go into great detail into the preparations for meditation, but they tell very little about the actual aim of it, the method of entry into the nature of reality. So whatever you have gathered in respect of this wonderful subject will stand you in good stead in your personal life and in your social life, or whatever kind of life that you live. In order that students of yoga may not be frightened by this tremendous nature of the object of yoga, Patanjali takes pain to explain the preparatory processes of yoga also, leading the student from one stage to another stage. These stages being called the Ashtanga, or the eight limbs of yoga. If you are able to directly commune your soul with the soul of the Supreme Being, there is no necessity to hear anything about these eight limbs. But as the soul will not respond so easily to your demand, in this arduous task on hand, and there will be repulsion and difficulties of various types due to the strength of the lower nature of human individuality. It has been thought proper by the sage Patanjali that the graduated steps also be mentioned. I made reference yesterday to the Yamas and Niyamas. Without going into the details of these items of Yamas and Niyamas, briefly I may say these represent the moral power of a person. If there is no moral strength, there will be deficiency felt in oneself from every side of the or every corner of the world. What do you mean by moral power? What does it mean actually? It is the strength of conviction that one maintains in regard to the proper objective of life. If the conviction wavers, there will be no such strength. Also, moral power means the honest onslaught of the soul in respect of the aim that is sought for, and not deviating the mind into any other direction than what is proper for the aim of yoga. You should not have double dealing in this process, because one voice will tell you that there are other aspects of reality than the one that you are seeking in your expected form of meditation. There are two voices possible coming up from within and telling you with equal force that there is something else also which you have missed in life. What you are theoretically conceiving as your goal of life is not everything. The problem arises because of the feeling that the aim of yoga is a theoretical concept. That which you have never seen with your eyes or heard with your ears, never come in contact in any manner whatsoever, looks like an ethereal theory, an abstraction, a concept, not an actual reality as you conceive it in the form of the objects of the senses. This difficulty presents itself again and again, and you are likely to consider even God Himself as a kind of theoretical concept, because concretely you cannot contact that being. You cannot contact any stage of yoga because of the pressure of another setup of values which have been considered by us right from our birth as realities proper. To bring about a complete transformation of the perception of values, an aspiration and a determination proper to achieve what you otherwise consider as a future possibility should be taken up in right earnest. Moral power is a simple thing to understand. It is an honest belief in one thing only, and not a divergent concession given to any other thing which also may be regarded as a value. All the values conceivable in any manner whatsoever are included in this great value of your pursuit in the practice of yoga. The whole thing is here before you in this great attempt on your part to achieve the aim of yoga. The way of yoga is not one way of living among many other possible ways. It is the only way worthwhile finally, because it is a gathering up of your personality into a total approach to the nature of a total reality. For this purpose, tremendous disciplines preparatory in their nature have been prescribed, namely a living of an austere life, honest life, good life and simple life. When this preparation becomes well established, you become ready to take the next step, namely to study your personality as would be required for the steadiness in meditation. The entire personality of ours is a dismembered conglomeration, as it were, of unconnected aspects which look like a single individual, most people are torn individuals. They look like one person, but they are many persons inside. Due to the ideologies which are variegated in their nature, all which clash among themselves, and no one knows what is good for oneself and what it is that one has to pursue. When, to repeat, you have enough confidence in the teaching that you have received, and you are prepared to be governed and instructed by a competent teacher along this path, you may be considered as having taken the first step in yoga. Steadiness of personality, which generally goes by the name of asana or posture, should be understood in its proper connotation. Generally, we understand by asana sitting in one position or performing some kind of exercise physically. Though these exercises may be regarded as part of the prescription in terms of asana, they are not the true meaning of it. It is an at-one-ment of all the aspects of your personality in a gathering, in the nature of a focusing of all your aspects in one direction only. The muscles, the nerves, the physiological functionings, the thought connected with them, all get gathered up in yoga asana. The practice of physical exercise, which is known as yoga asana, will bring no benefit to anyone if the mind is not cooperating with the asana. If your mind is thinking of purchasing a ticket in the railway station after half an hour, the mind is distracted and the body will not cooperate with that kind of thought. Because you are a divided personality, even when you are attempting to practice the first limb of yoga, all commitments should be set aside for the time being. And if the commitments are very pressing, they must be attended to first and then only take to the yoga asana or any kind of exercise. For the whole day you must be free, at least for the time being, when you are engaged in the initial stage of yoga. If the pressure from outside, social or political or any other thing, is very intense, these must be attended to first. Even intense hunger is not a good thing. If you are hungry, you should not do the yoga exercise. The body has to be satisfied so far as it is permitted for its maintenance. You must be a happy person first before you enter into yoga. Unhappy person, torn emotion, that is not a proper preparation. The alignment of one's layers in the personality is actually what is meant by the practice of yamas and niyamas. We are made up of various psychological strata of being. These strata have to stand in unison, in perfect harmony. That is the morality that is spoken of. It should not be thought that yoga asana is a simple thing and anybody can practice it. Otherwise it will become an acrobatic feat, but it will not benefit you spiritually speaking. Doing something alone without being something at the same time is contrary to the purpose. You have to be something first before you do something in connection with yoga. Actually, according to the prescription of Patanjali, the yoga posture is simple enough. It is not a complicated series of so many exercises as Hatha Yoga sometimes prescribes. Hatha Yoga exercises are good as something paving the way to flexibility of personality, that is not necessary for meditation. Shirasukhamasanam is the sutra. That posture which is very comfortable and steady in its nature may be regarded as the necessary posture for the purpose of meditation. You can choose any posture, whatever you like. Patanjali takes into consideration the inner components of personality when he takes you along these eight limbs. You are made up of many things inside. You are a social person, which is also something very important to remember. That social side is taken care of in the prescription of yamas. You have a personal side which is taken care of in the niyamas. Then you are a physical body which is the concern of the yoga exercise known as asana. But the whole function of the body depends upon the vital energy that is inside. Ka prana, as it is called. Your breathing process very much contributes to the nature of the operation of the physiological organs and the manner in which the physical body in general operates. When you are exhausted physically, say for instance after a long walking for many kilometers, your breathing will be totally disharmonious in comparison with the way in which you are supposed to breathe while you are calm and quiet. Desires which are very insistent may disturb the process of breathing. You will start heaving the breath in a disharmonious manner, then the desires disturb the feelings and the emotions, and calmness of mind will be far away from one's expectation if uncontrolled and unfulfilled desires persist disturbing you from within. Desires are not unimportant things. Either they have to be fulfilled as far as it is practicable and permissible, or they must be transformed into a higher power by the strength of analysis and meditation techniques. But they should not be allowed to persist like hidden diseases which will disturb the entire balance of your personality. To give a momentum to this technique of breathing, Patanjali prescribes certain methods by which you may regularize your breathing process. I am not going into very much detail into these methods, because you will find them described in any good textbook of yoga. I am briefly touching upon the stages mentioned. For the purpose of yoga practice, you need not go into the technology of breathing as Hatha Yoga details it in so many ways. What you require is a calm and quiet position that you have to maintain with undisturbed emotion and feeling, and sit in your room with windows open fully so that there may be an inflow of fresh air. Or you can sit outside in open so that you may breathe fresh air. Stuffy atmosphere should be avoided for the purpose of calculated yoga breathing. What you should do in the beginning is not to bother about the technique and the difficulties involved in pranayama, but just be seated and take a deep inhalation. We generally never breathe deeply. There is always shallow breathing due to the hurry involved in our practical day-to-day life. Everything is fast and quick in modern days. That fastness and hurry and quickness should be avoided as much as possible. Our movement should become quiet and simple. Take a deep inhalation and exhale the breath carefully, slowly, slowly, slowly. There is no need of retaining the breath, which you may attempt a little later. Deep inhalation, deep exhalation. May this be practiced for 15 minutes continuously. You will feel a refreshing change taking place in your person, even by this deep inhalation and deep exhalation process. The second stage would be to try the retention of the breath for a few seconds only after the deep inhalation is done. But don't go beyond the capacity of yours in holding the breath, because the retention should not end in suffocation or discomfort of any kind. Yoga is not discomfort. It is a comfortable, nice method, happy process always. So in the initial stages, try this method of deep inhalation and retention for a few seconds only, and then exhale the breath very, very slowly, calmly, without abrupt sneezing out. This you may continue for days and days together, which will maintain your general health, provided you do this breathing in fresh air. You should not be in a closed room where the breath is not moving at all. A little bit of movement of breath is very good. There must be movement of breath. It should not be a standstill atmosphere. After this process, as honest, sincere students of yoga, I would advise you not to go very much into the complicated forms of pranayama, since your aim is not merely breathing, but mental peace. The peace in the mind cannot be achieved merely by breathing process. Though many people think that breathing exercises themselves are enough to bring peace to the mind, they will not. Look at a watch, a timepiece or a clock here on the wall. You can hold with your finger the moving needle and you will find the mechanism stops operating. But lift your hand, immediately the mechanism will start operating automatically. This inner mechanism is the mind, the outer pointer is the prana. So when you pressurize the prana by any kind of exercise attended with the retention, it may appear that the mind is make to stand still. But when the breathing exercise is over, the mind will work once again in the same way as the clock. The cog inside will start operating the moment you lift your finger from the needle or the pointer of the clock. the important thing is to control the mechanism inside and not only to push the pressure on the pointer outside. The mechanism is very important, which is the mental process. The trouble with the prana arises due to the trouble in thinking itself. What is the trouble with thinking? I have already gone into great detail in this respect as to what is the trouble in thinking. You know very well, we are having wrong ideologies, wrong notions of what is proper in our life, and wrong contacts made with things and persons under the impression that these are the ways of attaining mental peace. You will not have mental peace by shifting yourself from place to place or living in physically isolated atmosphere when the mind craves for a thing and it is disturbed because of the absence of what it wants. Psychological calmness is possible only when there is the cessation of untoward and unnecessary cravings and longings which are rampant in the mind, mostly in every person who has not chalked out the proper path or a way of living and has very little idea as to what it is, the thing that he is aspiring for, and why does one live at all in this world. Such a doubt will arise. Why should I exist in this world? What for am I living? Such doubts will disturb the mind. You have to be a little bit of philosophical in your nature and study the whole structure of things, the whole universe. It is said by philosophers that ethics is based on metaphysics. That is, the foundation of reality determines the way of our behavior in life. And our conduct is the outcome of our concept of reality or the nature of the ultimate goal. So, the mind has to be taken care of principally, and you have to watch what you are thinking and feeling every day. It is very good for you to maintain a spiritual diary as it has been prescribed by Gurudev Swami Shivanandji Maharaj, or you can have another kind of diary as it is suited for your own personal purpose. It is necessary for you to watch. You have to be a self-checker of your own personality. How many times you have forgotten the purpose for which you are existing in this world? You make a note of this difficulty that you are facing in your diary. Actually, it is easier to note how many times you have been remembering it rather than say how many times you have forgotten it, because mostly it is forgotten. So you may mention it in other way. How many times have I been able to maintain a consciousness of the purpose for which I am living in this world? How many times I have been agitated, worried? You feel sometimes like cursing everything due to the disturbance in your mind, the cause of which is not clear to you. Your sufferings have some causes, but the mind cannot catch these causes. You simply feel the outcome of the operation of these causes, but why they are operating, you cannot find out. A little child will not know why the needle of a clock is moving at all, because the inner mechanism is not seen. So is the case with childlike, childish human behavior, which knows the difficulties of life, but no one knows the cause behind the difficulties. With these psychological preparations, in terms of the breathing process as well as thinking process, you may, as the Patanjali Maharaji tells you, take to the concentration of the mind technique. Naturally, usually, the mind cannot concentrate on anything continuously for more than a few seconds. The very existence of the mind depends upon the oscillation of the mind. Just as if a bicycle is to stand, it has to move. If it stands, it will fall down. The standing is equal to moving, in the case of a bicycle, for instance. Likewise, the mind can be said to be existing only when it is active. Otherwise, you can't know whether it is existing at all. You may be wondering, on what will I concentrate? I am not talking of samadhi now. The samadhi has been explained in detail, and if you have caught it well, so much good for you. But in the preparatory stage, the object of concentration cannot be deciphered easily. That which you like best is the object of your concentration. That which you do not like, you cannot concentrate upon. Here again another difficulty will arise, because no one can say what one likes best. Today you will like something, tomorrow you will say that is not the proper thing for me, I like another thing. Is there anything in the world conceivable which will satisfy you immensely? You will not be able to answer this question to your own self, because it may appear that nothing in the world can satisfy you completely. Because of this difficulty, people have taken to religious courses of concentration of concept of God. God conceived as a very, very beloved, dear object for concentration. In Sanskrit, this beloved object, which is divinity in nature, is called Ishtadevata, the God of your heart. You love a God. Every religious person has a God. Whatever be the nature of that God, on that you concentrate. There should be no difficulty in concentrating on the image of God pictured by your mind, because it is taken for granted the God whom you are concentrating upon is the source of great blessing for you. Otherwise, that being cannot be regarded as your God at all. There is no God who cannot satisfy you. A full satisfaction is guaranteed by the God whom you are worshipping. This Ishtadevata, the object of meditation, which is the finally fulfilling thing in the world, or as you can conceive it in your mind, that should be regarded as all in all. Your love for this object should be 100%. You should not say that this object is like any other object in the world. It is all the objects. Because if it is only one among the many other things available in this world, the mind will move towards those other possibilities external to this chosen object, and concentration will be disturbed. Unless you have a faith that the object that you have chosen for your concentration is going to give you everything and satisfy you completely, concentration is not possible. But the concept of Ishta, the idea of a divinity who will satisfy you fully, is difficult to entertain in the mind. So the lesser techniques of concentration also are preserved, such as you concentrate on a beautiful thing. Mind is attracted to anything that is beautiful. It is up to you to find out what is beautiful for you. Go on looking at it again and again, the mind will get absorbed. You know very well how your mind gets absorbed in the object of beauty. Why does it attract? Why is it that the beautiful object attracts your mind? Because there is something lacking in your mind. The so-called beauty that you seem to be perceiving in an object is the exact counterpart of what is a lacuna in your own mind. The negative void that is created in your mind is filled completely by the nature of that object which you regard as beautiful. The beauty is nothing but the characteristic of that which can fully complement or act as a counterpart to the deficiencies that you feel in your own self. That is why things look beautiful in different ways to different people, because what one person considers as beautiful will not be regarded as beautiful by another person, because beauty as such is not an object of perception. is only a characteristic which is foisted upon some object as would be suitable to fulfill the psychological need of a person in a person, and so the beauty concept changes from person to person, and no such thing as absolute beauty can be seen anywhere. However, you can mind your own business and take to concentration on a beautiful thing which you regard from your point of view as the most desirable thing for you. A devotee went to Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa Deva, teach me meditation. Sri Ramakrishna said, meditate on that which you love immensely. The devotee said, I love immensely my granddaughter. All right, you can meditate on granddaughter. There is no objection, he said. Because when your mind is believing that the most attractive thing is the granddaughter, there is no use of trying to concentrate on any other thing. Go on pouring your affection on that most beautiful thing you regard as your beloved, until a time comes when you are fed up with this concentration and you had enough of this beauty, this attraction, because one day or other you will be so much satisfied with something that you don't require it anymore. Even the most delicious lunch or dinner cannot be poured into your mouth again and again continuously. There is a limit for that also. The satisfaction of a very good lunch is limited. It cannot be indefinitely or continuously prolonged throughout the day. So is the case with beautiful things. There cannot be an infinite beauty possible. It is a finite beauty. So when that finitude of the beauty has had an envy or a full satisfaction, you will find that you have to shift your attention from this particular granddaughter or whatever it is to something else which the mind will consider as most beautiful. But this is not a proper way of meditation. This is only an escapism technique which the mind is adopting, and you can meditate on your little baby which has been born just now and you love very much. It looks very beautiful indeed. You can concentrate on that, but this is not yoga meditation. Because here, in this kind of meditation on beautiful things, sensual or sensory action is predominant. Meditation which is purely spiritual is not sensory action. So that which satisfies the sense organs cannot be regarded as a pure object for spiritual meditation. You have to be satisfied fully with anything until you don't require it again. Since the concentration on beautiful objects has this difficulty or this problem of compelling your mind to shift from one object to another, and it has the characteristic of a sort of sensory enjoyment, it is suggested that no object in the world can be regarded actually as a true or proper object for spiritual meditation. That is why the notion of God is brought in. Because God is not a sensual object. It is an all-inclusive being. Very important to remember. All objects in this world are not all-inclusive. They are external to you and they can satisfy you temporarily for some time only, as long as the senses want them. But otherwise, you will get disgusted with the most interesting thing in the world, one day or the other. So, the best thing that is suggested in religious parlance is meditation on your notion of God Almighty, whatever be that concept. Because God being not a sensory object and all inclusive in its nature, that concept of God that you are entertaining in your mind will be able to fulfill you to the immensest extent that you are expecting. But never think that concept of God is an ethereal abstraction of your mind. It is a concrete reality. Anything that the mind assumes as real will actually become real. Because all things are connected with the mind in some way or the other, and any part of the universe can be tapped and struck and attacked for the purpose of unleashing the potential that is behind any particular object. You can concentrate even on a dot on a wall, or even a candy flame, or even a pencil, or any object, because all objects in the world are organically connected with the total universe because of the fact that the universe is one single living organism. So when you touch anything in the world, you are touching the whole world. So any object can be taken for the purpose of concentration, provided you believe in the validity of that concentration and have no doubts about it. So much about concentration of mind. Hari Om Tat Sat.